Thank you. Thanks to the organizers for inviting me. So is it okay? Am I hearable?
Yeah? Yes, all good.
All good. Okay. So this is a joint work with Francesco Ortelli, who is currently a PhD student at our institute. And here's the contents. I should say that I gave a talk on April 29 in the Mathematics and Data seminar. And this is going to be very similar. So if you have seen it, don't waste your time and go do something else with your family or whatever. Otherwise, I did make a little change. So let's see, the contents is statistics. It's theoretical work on adaptive estimation and L1 minimization. So strong links with the lasso, if you know what it is. If you don't, it's no problem. And then I added a little toy result on Gaussian width, which has to do with the theory we will develop, but actually there's very little probability theory in there. So I thought, well, let's put this in. It's a toy example, and maybe you can tell me what you think. Then the emphasis in the talk will be on sparsity and interpolating vectors. So I have to explain what that is. And the examples will be trend filtering, image reconstruction, and total variation on graphs. So here we go. So I do this all for the simplest possible model. That's the signal plus noise model, where you have a vector y of observations, n-dimensional. And this vector has an unknown mean, which I denote by this red function, or vector f0. And so I'm going to assume for simplicity that's a Gaussian random vector, so with an unknown mean and variance iid, well, independent components, variance 1. So the noise is Gaussian, standard Gaussian with variance 1, of just not to have too many digressions, the simplest possible model. And then we want to estimate this unknown signal, and we do it in the following way. This is called the analysis estimator. So you do just least squares, but say you believe that certain linear combinations of the vector are small or almost zero, so that the L1 norm of these linear combinations is believed to be small. So you put a penalty proportional to this L1 norm, and these linear combinations are given with this matrix D. It's an M times N matrix, which is given depending on the problem. So depending on what you believe the structure is in the signal. And that's called the analysis matrix. So the number of observations is N, and the number of possible restrictions, so the number of the length of this vector D of F is M from Mary. And lambda is a tuning parameter. So for instance, you could think of a graph with nodes, and for adjacent nodes, maybe you believe, so at each node you observe a value, the signal, and then you believe that for adjacent nodes, the signal is most of the time, the change in signal is almost constant or constant. So that sometimes there is a change, but on average, in general, there the signal is more or less piecewise constant. If you believe that, that would be a good idea then to put the total variation penalty on the graph, which is saying that you take as D the incidence matrix of the graph. So I want to show you a preview of what I want to prove, but then I need a little bit notation. So this given analysis matrix, it has M columns. And if I so you look at D of F, let's see here, D of F. Maybe many of them are zero. D of F is a vector, and most entries you believe are zero. So a potential set where the entries are zero, I call that S, sort of the set of active restrictions. So S is a subset of these indices. They index these rows. And the matrix with these rows, where outside the set S, things are probably zero, you call D of minus S. And then the dimensionality of the problem is the dimension of the null space of this matrix. Yeah, so the null space is the set of vectors for which D of F is zero. And the dimension of that null space is, so to say, the dimension of F. So the dimensionality, which is kind of the number of parameters. And what we want to do is trade off approximation error against estimation error. So the true signal F0, maybe you approximate it by something else, F. And then this is the approximation error, right? But if you have to have that many parameters, R parameters, then the estimation error will be, roughly speaking, something like the number of parameters divided by the number of observations. So that's the estimation error. And you want to trade those two off. So I want to show that this estimator, which is here, does this trade off. And you see from the formula, you don't really see any unknown constants like dimension of the problem. So it has to do that without knowing the dimensionality of the problem and where the restrictions are. So here's just a preview of the, so that you get an idea what kind of things you can prove. So the theorem says, first of all, it's not on the slide because the slide is a bit too small. But suppose you take the tuning parameter properly, and I have to explain how to do that. But then, if you have an arbitrary function, which is here in bold face, and I call that from now on an oracle, because as we will see, it's sort of going to trade off estimation error and approximation error. So theoretically, but in principle, it's an arbitrary function with active set. So that's the set where the restrictions are non-active, that's the terminology. So where D of F is not zero. Then with large probability, so U and V are arbitrary. With large probability, the prediction error of the estimator can be bounded by the approximation error and the estimation error. So if you think of that as approximation error and estimation error, the fact that you can take here F arbitrary means that you can minimize over F, over boldface F. Huh? So get an automatic trade-off. And what's this estimation error? Well, there's the number of parameters divided by the number of observations. That's fine. Then there is a parametric term, which is also fine. That means, so if you have just one parameter, then this term would be there as well. You can't, it's of order 1 over square root of n. Eh? So V is, say, some big number, but still, it's the deviation from for the parametric case. And then comes something which is in purple, more or less. And this purple thing is called the effective sparsity.
So I have a question, Sarah.
Yeah, sure.
Just to clarify. So where's the dependence on U on the right hand side?
Yeah, so it's that's a very good question. So that's in the tuning parameter.
I see. How do you choose this tuning parameter?
So that will come because I need a little bit time to explain that.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So but just at a preview of the theorem, so it's completely not complete. And so we see we have some work to do. But just also a look ahead, the kind of things you can prove. So I will give you several examples, but this is a total variation example. Well, the result is sort of well known, so it's not new, but so I want to show you other examples as well. But to get an idea, yeah, so the total variation of a vector or a function, I use these terminology both, it's just the sum of the increments. Now you use total variation as a penalty if you believe that the underlying signal is more or less piecewise constant with a few jumps. Now well approximated by such a function. So so we have this potential oracle and we say, okay, let's let it have a couple of jumps. And the distance between jumps, I call that dk, distance between jumps of the oracle, this boldface function. Then take your tuning parameter like this, which involves the distance between jumps, the maximal distance between jumps. And then with, so here you see the u appearing as u is just, this is just the term which is the maximum of IID Gaussians if you have n of them. So large with large probability, it's less than this. And so 1 minus e to the power u comes from that term, this term here. Okay. So this is your tuning parameter. And then with large probability, you get this trade-off where gamma, which is called the effective sparsity, is something like 1 over the harmonic mean of the distance between jumps. Okay, and then we can specialize to further cases. So that will all come, but this is again a look ahead. I hope it's a little bit motivating why we are doing all this. So back to the main results, the questions you can ask is how to choose the tuning parameter, what is this effective sparsity, and how does it depend on the noise? So for tuning, I do something very simple. Actually, let me go back here. I have here this reference. So this theorem is a modified version of a theorem in the paper by Dallalian, Heybeery, and Lederer. It's just for a different context, so to speak. Okay, so this idea is of decomposing a vector in terms of its projection on this null space and the anti-projection. So that's the projection on the orthocomplement of the null space. So you can decompose that, and the projection on the null space, that's already in the right space, because that's a space, say, with small dimension, and this one has the right number of parameters, but this part is sort of the nuisance part that you want to kill by, that's what the penalty is for, to kill this part. So we have to look at that. And we choose the penalty in such a way, so the tuning parameter in such a way that this noise part is overruled. Okay. And now comes the dictionary. So just let's call D of F B. So call that the coefficients. I'm a little bit hand waving here because there may be non-penalized coefficients. But good. And then F, the anti-projection of this on this null space, we write it in terms of a linear combination of dictionary functions. And then the length of these dictionary functions, I call that the noise weights. Okay, and if they're very small, there's less noise to be killed, so to speak. So here's a picture. You can think of the original function being expanded in terms of a global dictionary. And then if you project it, you have to also project this global dictionary, and then you become this kind of local dictionary, and the distance of the global dictionary to the null space is called the noise weights. And then you take your tuning parameter larger than the maximal noise weight times a term coming from the maximum of IID Gaussians. Okay? Well, okay, you may ask why? Yeah, so why? Let's click why. And here I have this little intermezzo. I just put that in because I think it's kind of nice, but also to put some probability theory in. So what do you do typically in these kind of problems? So in statistics, in empirical risk minimization, you look indeed at the Gaussian widths.
Sarah, I just have a question from a participant, so I'll just unmute. Yes, Danielle, you have a question? Whoops. Let's see. Danielle, I'm trying to unmute you and it's not working. All right, maybe ask. I'm trying to unmute and
he also has to unmute himself.
Ah, right. Okay. Well, maybe he should ask a question on the chat. All right. Maybe it's a, sorry. Okay. Sarah, go ahead.
Okay. Let's see. So, the Gaussian width is the expected value of the supremum of Gaussian random variables. And in this case of interest is to look at vectors which have this restriction. So this L1 norm bounded, say, by 1, and L2 norm bounded by something small, delta. Delta is here arbitrary. But we have in mind something small. And then you look at the expected value of the supremum over all such vectors. And that's called the Gaussian width. And I call it local because there's this assumption on the L2 norm as well. So how would you find a bound for this? Typically, what you do is you look at this space of vectors, functions, you calculate its entropy, and then you bound this by Dudley's entropy integral. Or you use generic chaining if that helps. So that's sometimes helps to get better bounds. Now, if you do it very naively, you get log terms, but you get explicit constants. So I give this bound, if you don't mind log terms and you like explicit constants. Because when you calculate entropies, typically you don't have these constants, and also the entropy integral, Dudley's entropy integral involves constants, and before you know it, everything blows up. So if you look at this Gaussian width, well, let's just look at the proof. Here you have this inner product with a vector and the noise. The noise is IID Gaussian. So I decompose the vector in its projection and the anti-projection. Here I apply some kind of Cauchy-Schwarz. And here I apply the dual norm inequality. Yeah, that's the inner product is bounded by L infinity norm times L1 norm. Here you see the L1 norm. And then we take the soup and take expectations and you're done. And then you get this.
Sarah, can you remind us what the psi is here?
So the psi, it's exactly this. So this function,
okay,
expand in terms of a basis function. So this function f is the sum over a dictionary times the coefficients.
Okay.
And so these are vectors in n-dimensional space. This is the dictionary. I'll give examples, Okay. So, okay, and then if you look at this, this is for arbitrary subset. So you can trade off the two terms by choosing the subset such that they are of the same order and as small as possible. And I there are several examples, but just to have a concrete example, which is easy, if you take the total variation, the supremum over the functions with total variation bounded by 1 locally is bounded by this. And then, well, don't worry too much. So S is the, well, you just divide 1 up to n into S equal distant points. And then you trade off the two terms, and then you get that the supremum behaves like the square root of the L2 norm. So that's the modulus of continuity for functions of bounded variation. And then there's a log term. So this is the right order. This is the same as what you get from Dudley's entropy integral. But then, of course, you don't get this log term, which is n to the power minus log to the power 1/4. So it's not so big. And you can do similar things for other problems, for instance, for higher order differences and so on. But this gives a little, so this is just an intermezzo, but it gives a little bit an idea where the choice of the tuning parameter comes from. So the previous was about bounding expectations, and this is a bounding in probability. And then you get the same expressions. And then with concentration, just smaller order terms coming in. And then this comes from the bounding the projection on the null space, and this comes from bounding the projection the anti-projection, and there appears a term, and we kill that by taking lambda bigger than that term. So that's where it comes from. So that's the tuning parameter. Now the effective sparsity. Effective sparsity is like the number of parameters, but it's typically larger. And it depends on the active set of the oracle and also on the signs of the active oracle, where the oracle is non-zero. And also because there's noise, it depends on the noise by weights, which are like this. And this is a quantity which is less than or equal to one because I choose lambda larger than what's on top. So what is it? Well, here's the theorem again. And remember, that's why we want to look at it. Effective sparsity, what is it? So it depends on the sign of the oracle, which is here arbitrary, but you can minimize the terms, and then it's an oracle. So here we go. For first some notation, if you have an arbitrary vector in m dimensions, I call for the set S B of S, the coefficients inside the set S, and B of minus S, the coefficients outside the set S. Good. Now, what's effective sparsity? We fix a sign vector with dimension little s, which is the cardinality of big S, the set of indices. So this one is fixed. And then I complete the vector to m dimensions. And we call that an interpolating vector. So at the set S, it's plus or minus one as given. And in between, you interpolate. And how we will see in examples. Then these weights, these depend on the noise in our theory. And then the effective sparsity, here it is the minimum of D transpose Q, the L2 norm of that squared, where Q is such an interpolating vector, which is in absolute value bounded by one minus the weights. Okay, that's the effective sparsity. And if there's no noise, then the weights are zero. And then we call it the noiseless effective sparsity. And then the requirement on this interpolating vector is that it's not bigger than one in absolute value. So this is closely related with the dual certificate used in noiseless L1 optimization, but it's something like a quantitative version of that. So maybe you know this dual certificate idea. So it's like this. So you have some points where D of F is non-zero, and then it's either positive or negative. So if it's positive, we put a plus one. And if it's negative, we put a minus one, the sign. And then we interpolate. And we try to do it in such a way that D transpose Q has small L2 norm. Okay. And because there's noise, we can't just interpolate as we want. We want the Q to be less than something, so really less than one according to these weights. So we have to push it down somewhat. So then the interpolation due to the noise will not be so good. And then this noisy effective sparsity will be larger than the one without noise. So let's look at this total variation example. So the total variation is the sum of the increments. So D is the incidence matrix of such a path graph. And D transpose Q is again something like taking the increments all the time. That's kind of a discrete variant, or it's just in the background is a partial integration here. Okay, now if you have the oracle, say I call it F here, then it has certain jumps, and T1, T2, and so on, Ts are the locations of the jumps. There are S of those jumps. We look at the distance between jumps and call that D. Now let's look at these projections. So if you have, say, a function, I wrote it like this because then it fitted on the screen. It's like a path graph. Then at certain points, it has jumps, these red edges. And otherwise it's constant. So it's piecewise constant, and then the projection on the space of piecewise constant functions is just taking the average within such a piecewise, within such a piece. Huh? So the anti-projection is just the deviation from the local averages. And that gives you the dictionary. So let's just look at global averages, because local averages, we just have to rewrite it in the notation, but otherwise it's the same. So if you take F minus its average, then it's just, the dictionary is just like this. It's psi ij is just counting. If you start at I, how often you pass the edge j. So let me look here again. So you start at a certain point I, and you go to all other points, all other nodes, and then you pass, say, this edge a certain number of times, and that's the dictionary. And the L2 norm of that is then this nice function. Looks like this. Yeah, so near the border, it's almost zero, and it's biggest in the middle. And so these occur in the tuning parameter. So you have to take, if these are the noise weights, you have to take lambda larger than this term, which is always there for all problems, times these noise weights, which in this case is square root the maximal distance between jumps. Okay, so that's more or less what is happening. If you have a piecewise constant function, it's just a linear combination of bump functions. So that's the dictionary, the global dictionary. Then if you do the projections, it looks a little bit different. But if you have an active jump, so that's an active bump function here, and a non-active one, well, their distance is more or less the area of this piece here, but it's the L2 distance. So the L2 is the square root of the L1 distance. So you just get square roots all the time, all over the place. Now this interpolating vector, so say the function jumps at t1, t2, and ts. It has a jump up here, a jump down here, and a jump up here. Now, if there were no noise, the best linear, the best interpolation would be just linear, because d transpose q is then just taking derivatives. So that's the best linear approximate. That's best. You should not even go down here. You just go straight through to the next jump. So that would be the linear interpolation, and then d transpose q is then piecewise constant. And then you take the L2 norm of that, and then you get something like 1/2 the harmonic mean of the distances between jumps. And you can imagine why. Let me just go back quickly. If two jumps are very close to each other, then to interpolate, you have to do it very steeply. And that's why 1/2 the distance between jumps occurs in this interpolation. So this is the noiseless effective sparsity. And with noise, you have these weights. So let me, here's the picture again. And this is with noise. So instead of going linearly, it's more like square roots around here. And the square roots, I think I more or less indicated where that comes from. Okay, and then if you take something like, it's not a derivative, but more or less discrete derivative of this function, it's no longer a piecewise constant, but it doesn't hurt too much. You get some log terms. So this gives you the effective sparsity. Okay, more or less.
I have a question. So you call it effective sparsity. How does that compare to the sparsity that you start with?
Okay, so let's look at here. If you look here, you say, okay, yes. In this particular example, there's here a sum over S terms, and you have S jumps, so the number of parameters is S plus one, it's the overall mean, and the location of the jumps. So you have S plus one parameters, and that's this term, S plus one parameters.
Okay.
I want it actually also to be s plus 1. Well, it looks like it's a sum of s terms, so it's also maybe s, but that's not true, of course. Mm-hmm. So it's actually more like s squared.
But yes.
In the Turing parameter, if you do that, if you can, there's also a 1 over s. So in the end, it's still okay. So let me just give this particular example. So if the jumps are equally spaced, effect dispersed is more like s plus 1 squared, and this constant is just not really the real thing. So it's s plus 1 squared instead of s plus 1. But the Turing parameter you can take very small. If there are very many jumps, you can take it smaller, which makes sense, of course, because you project on a larger space, so there's less left over to kill.
I see.
Yeah, so that's why if you take it like this, this square cancels out again, and you're happy you get, as a rate of convergence, the number of parameters divided by the number of observations, and a log term. And this is the right thing. I put here a square because that follows from what I just told you, but you can get rid of one log term here, and then you get exactly the type of result you typically have in these kind of problems. Okay?
All right. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Let's see. If you go to higher order derivatives, I'll just go quicker because of the time. But just to convince you, say second order discrete derivatives, like this. You use that if you believe that your function is more or less piecewise linear. And then the kinks are at certain points. And the distance between kinks I call again d. And so you get this kind of minimization problem. It's almost like using ReLU activation functions, never mind. So let's see. The dictionary is hinge functions or rectifier linear units. You can look at projections. Before you had here just j, now in two derivatives you have a power 3, but everything goes through. Here's the picture for the interpolation. Here are the kinks, kink down, kink up. Instead of linear interpolation, if there's no noise, you do quadratic interpolation. And then d transpose q is more or less taking, again, second derivatives, which is piecewise constant, and you get something like 1 over the distance between kinks to the power 3. But there's noise, okay, so you have to take into account the noise, and it's not difficult, but you just calculate these projections and anti-projections, and that gives you an additional log term as compared to the noiseless effective sparsity. And so on. For if you take n discrete derivatives, it's 1 over the distance between the nth minus 1 jump, the jump of the nth minus 1 discrete derivatives to the power 2 n minus 1. So if n equals 2, this is 3, and so on. And let me just show the result. So you get this estimation error. Here comes the number of parameters. I have to think a little bit. S plus 1 or S plus 2? I forgot. I think it's probably S plus 2. It's not completely clear, but I multiply here with n because the trick is here that you have this projection on the null space, and I can make it a bit larger as long as the dimension is not going to be too much larger, and that helps very much. So then you get much smaller anti-projections and the right effective sparsity, in the sense that, again, you can recover that the rate of convergence with equidistant jumps is more or less the number of parameters divided by the number of observations. So in higher dimensions, you can look at higher order discrete derivatives, but let's just look at total variation. And for instance, you can define the Hardy-Krause variation. So that's like taking a function of two variables, x and y, and taking the derivative with respect to x, and then the derivative with respect to y, and summing all that up. Yeah, so the derivative with respect to x, and then with respect to y, and then take the difference again. You know what I'm saying? So that's useful for matrices or pictures. And the dictionary is half intervals. If you look at the distance between two half intervals, it's more or less this area. So the projections, they behave like square roots of those areas. And now the effect is sparsity. So you have this two-dimensional picture, a two-dimensional grid. And some points are active. So I don't know if this is optimal, but what I did is I define a rectangular tessellation with squares or rectangulars around each active point. And then I do the interpolation like this. So this is what it looks like in two dimensions, like little tents. And if the jumps down, then the tents are downwards, okay? That's it. And then these areas around jumps, they play a role in the effective sparsity. Effective sparsity is something like 1 over the area around active jumps. Okay, well, it's just more or less all in the same spirit. Here's an effective point, and then these are the areas around it. Okay, so that gives the result for total variation in two dimensions. And again, you can ask, does this more or less give that the rate of convergence is active parameters divided by number of observations? And what I get is actually an additional term. So if they're roughly on a regular grid, the active points, the rate of convergence is number of parameters, numbers of observations, and then comes an additional term, which has to do with the dimensionality of the problem. And I don't know whether it can be improved, but I do know it can be improved. I realize that you can put s to the power 1/3 here, but I don't know whether you can get rid of this nuisance term here. It's a bit, okay. You can do it in higher dimensions. Let's skip that. So the final is total variation on graphs. Let me check how much time. I don't know. So we have a graph.
You have 10, 15 minutes.
Yeah. Oh, that's good. So let's see. We have a graph, a given graph, with vertices V, edges E, and the number of vertices is N. The signal is some values at the nodes of the graph, and we observe these values with noise. Okay, like before. And the total variation over the graph is just the sum of the differences for adjacent nodes. Then we do least squares with the total variation penalty on the graph. Good. So what we considered before was the path graph, and that's just the one-dimensional total variation. And well, you can consider all kinds of graphs, and it's sort of not too difficult to extend, but I skip that. I just want to look at the difficult case. So let me go first to the, so in the difficult, what is difficult for graphs is the noise. So let's look at that. So suppose you have, if you project a function on this null space, it means it is constant on subgraphs. Yeah, so here's a graph. And let's say these colors indicate whether there's a change or not. So here it's purple, there it's orange. So this is an active edge. This is an active edge, that one. I hope I did it correctly. And that one. Okay, so here you have, if you take these subgraphs, or let's put it like this one. There, they're all of the same color. Yeah, there. So that's, if you project on such a null space, it just again means that you take the function piecewise constant on a subgraph, namely equal to its average. So that means, like before, if you want to find a dictionary, you just yeah, you do these path ideas. So let's just see. So to find the dictionary, it suffices to look at the dictionary for the whole graph and then just reformulate it for the subgraphs. Okay. So let's do it for the whole graph first. So let's say V and then this arrow V prime means there is a path from node V to V prime within the graph, so within these edges. Then the dictionary is just counting up to the sign. If you go from one node to the next, you take a certain path. How often do you use the edge E? Okay, so that's the dictionary. I don't think I need this slide. This is an old slide. So the dictionary says, okay, you have this dictionary times the coefficients. So F minus its overall mean is expanded in terms of this dictionary. So the noise weights are the L2 norm of the dictionary elements. Maybe I forgot a 1 over N here. I don't know. So it's just you have to count how often do you use these edges. And so if there is a graph with no cycles, there's only one path from V to V prime and there's nothing to choose. But if you have a graph with cycles, there are several paths. So you can use several dictionaries. That's more or less saying, okay, you can't invert the matrix, you use some kind of generalized inverse. Okay, so let's look at a particular case. This is a complicated graph for our problem. It's a grid in two dimensions. And I look at the total variation, which is just counting these increments, these little differences for these edges. So in function terminology, if you have a function, this corresponds to taking the function of x and y, taking the derivative with respect to x and then integrating over all y and taking the derivative with respect to y and then integrating over all x. And that's kind of the total variation we're considering here. Now just look at the special case. Suppose the underlying oracle is just like this, just two values, which I gave colors, but it's some value, but let's say red and purple. If that's the underlying oracle, then, well, it has dimension 2. Just two values. So is the rate of convergence, the prediction error, then of order 2 divided by n? Or if you're from a different world, you could say, okay, if I go at each node here, there's a jump from red to purple, and there are square root n of them. So I have square root n jumps. So is the rate of convergence maybe square root n divided by its sample size? So let's see. So don't look at the formula, but just what we do is count the number of edges, number of times an edge is used if we take paths. So what paths do we choose? So here's a node, and I go to all the other nodes, say here on the left upper corner, and then maybe I use this path a certain number of times. I have to count that. Now how to go, which path do we take? Maybe just straight lines. Yes, no detours. And if you take straight lines, you have to of course round things off to stay on the grid. So what is to come is I'm going to say, well, I'm not going to take straight lines. I'm going to give the function the possibility to make little detours. And the reason is the following. So I only have to look locally for the dictionary. But at the border where the jumps are, so to speak, I want the weights to be very small because then I can choose a smooth interpolating vector. If I take straight lines, the typical dictionary you would use in this kind of problems, the weights are small overall, but they're near the boundary, they're all relatively big. And that gives me trouble or, well, trouble. So just to sketch the idea, so I have a parameter, which I call C here, which says something about, am I taking detours or not? If I don't take detours, so something like straight lines, shortest path, which are more or less straight, then the noise weights behave like log n. And that leads to choosing the tuning parameter larger than log n divided by n. Yeah, I think that's right. There's a square root. If you take the square, it's square root. And then there's another square root log n. So that's right. But the effective sparsity is very large. And that's roughly because I have these square root n jumps. And if I interpolate them here, I have to interpolate like I'm at a sign, say a plus one, and then I just go down straight to zero. So the derivative is just one or n. I forgot. You have very high derivatives and you have very big effective sparsity. And the rate of convergence is then something like, well, so it's this divided by times tuning parameter, we give you a 1 over square root of n rate of convergence. And which is the minimax rate. But we're not doing minimax, we want to be adaptive. Now, if you make these little detours, which is parameterized by this parameter C, so that near the border you get smaller noise weights, but overall you get bigger noise weights. So overall bigger noise weights means that you have to take your tuning parameter larger, but the effective sparsity becomes much smaller. And that's because now, where is it? Here at the border, the noise weights are nice, small things, small values. And then if you take lambda squared times effective sparsity, you get the rate of convergence n to the power minus 3/4. And that's, in fact, if you look in this paper, they Chatterjee and Goswami, they look at, not at this problem, but at the constraint problem. And they show that this cannot be improved. So we are on the right track. Okay, so let me finish here. Conclusion. First of all, the problems that I discussed here, they're the, if you look at the dictionary, they're highly correlated. So it's a highly correlated design, but still you can find proof adaptive results. These interpolating vectors, they are useful for structured problems like what we looked at. And they're an improvement of restricted eigenvalue conditions, which are in the literature for the Lasso. These are conditions, if you would use them here, you would get no results. So you have to be more careful than using these restricted eigenvalue conditions, which are very common. And finally, these total variation penalties are adaptive. This is what we shown. You can look at other more. That's a project, of course, to look at further problems where you can apply this general technique. And a remark, things can be extended to other loss functions. And we did that for logistic loss in detail now. Okay, that's it, folks. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Sarah. I guess now we'll take questions either on the chat or raise your hands. And then we'll see. Any questions for Sarah? I have a question while we wait. So in the last setting, I have a question on the chat. Oh, thank you. In the last theorem, where you get the error of 1 over square root of n. Mm-hmm. So can you go back to your slides? I missed the what are the assumptions here? Are there special assumptions on F0 or?
Yeah, it's just this special case.
Oh, it's really the special case.
It's really this special case.
I see.
Otherwise, okay. This kind of squared structures, but if it's arbitrary, right. I don't know how to calculate the correct path yet, at least.
I see. Okay. Yeah. Okay. All right, thank you. Any other questions for Sarah. I guess not. So I will unmute everybody and thank you again. So I unmute everybody and clap. Thank you.
I'll stop.
Okay. Okay, thanks, Sarah. Now we'll take a little break. Next talk, I should say that we'll have Sarah. Sarah, if you can stay at the end, we'll do breakout rooms. So if you want to get into more details.